All right, how's everybody doing this morning? Pretty good, alive, awake, enthusiastic? Well, we'll get there if you're not. My name is Craig Sanborn, and I'm the high school pastor. I have the privilege of working with high schoolers at this church. And I'm excited to be able to share in the series that we're going through right now, simply called The Walk. One of the cool things about this series that we're going through is you're going to get the opportunity to hear from different pastors on staff here at the church in the coming weeks. And so today, we talk about one component of our walk with Christ, a key component in our walk with Christ. And if we are not implementing this key component in our walk with Christ, our walk with Christ is going to struggle. We'll just say that. So let me tell you about Mitch Ellis. Mitch Ellis set a world record by breaking 3,362 wood boards in 1 hour. The gentleman whose record he beat, unfortunately, he only went 52 minutes because he ran out of boards. So you're going to have to help me out, I think. So here's Mitch Ellis breaking boards, potentially. If not. All right, we'll work on that. Mohamed Karamanovic broke 23 pairs of coconuts by hand in 1 minute, defeating my old record of 22, which is power. The most one-finger push-ups in 30 seconds was 41. That was achieved by Zai Guzong on December 8th, 2011. That is power. In 1999, John Evans balanced a 352-pound car on his head for 33 seconds. That is power. Patty Doyle achieved an incredible 1,500,230 documented push-ups over the course of a year. That is power. Now, even though those are absolutely positively great examples of power, nothing compares to another type of power. It's a power that I believe few of us fully understand. It's a power that we do not tap into nearly enough. It's a power that moves mountains, heals the sick, tears down racism, it restores marriages, it renovates victims of abuse, it will derail depression, a power that helps runaways find a home, it annihilates anger, breaks down strongholds of addiction, it cripples cults and will bring atheists to their knees. I'm talking about the power of prayer. As we talk about our walk with Christ, we have to talk about prayer. So we're going to read a passage now in the book of James chapter 5, and I'm going to ask you to read it with me. To make sure that you're with me, I'm going to ask you to stand one more time this morning. But your part is easy. Your part is even highlighted in yellow if you did not bring your Bible. And anytime you see the word pray, prayer, or praise, that's your cue. I'll cover the rest, all right? James chapter 5, the prayer of faith. Is anyone among you in trouble? Let them pray. Is anyone happy? Let them sing songs of praise. Is anyone among you sick? Let them call the elders of the church to pray over them and anoint them with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer offered in faith will make the sick person well. The Lord will raise them up. If they have sinned, they will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. Elijah was a human being just as we are. He prayed earnestly that it would not rain, and it did not rain on the land for 3.5 years. Again, he prayed, and the heavens gave rain, and the earth produced its crop. Let's pray. Father God, we just come again this morning, and we give you praise that we can come and have a conversation with the creator of heaven and earth. Lord, I pray right now that each and every person would leave this place different than when they arrived. Lord, have your way in our lives. And I pray this in your son Jesus' name. Amen. Go ahead and have a seat. When I was a freshman in college, I went to Northwestern College, now known as the University of Northwestern St. Paul. As much as I enjoyed my time there, I only lasted a year. When I was home on Christmas break, I needed, of course, to go back to school after break. And I needed my checkbook. I could not find my checkbook. I had credit cards, my school ID, money, and a lot of important things. I was tearing my house apart, trying to find my checkbook. And you know you're desperate to find what you're looking for when you begin to look in places you had not been. I'm up in my attic digging around in old boxes. I'm out in the doghouse. I'm downstairs in the basement. I'm looking everywhere. And after an hour of trying everything and looking everywhere, I'm standing in my bedroom and I had this thought. Ding! Hey, Craig, why don't you pray about the situation, you dummy? All right? I feel the Holy Spirit called me a dummy at that moment. And I'm standing in my room and I said, why not? And I put my hands on my hips and I say something to the effect of, Lord, you know I need my checkbook. It's got credit cards, it's got money, it's got my school ID, it's got my driver's license. I really don't feel that I can leave the house without it. So Lord, would you help me find my checkbook? In Jesus' name, amen. And when I opened my eyes and I said amen, I was looking at my clothes drawer. And there on top of my clothes drawer was a stack of cassette tapes. Now, students, I maybe need to tell you right now what I mean by cassette tape. They're these little plastic things, and they play music or words, and you might think, oh, no, Pastor Craig, I have a cassette tape in my parents' minivan. Well, that's, you're thinking of a cassette adapter. That's not really a cassette tape, it's an adapter. But anyways, another time. There, in the middle of a stack of about 20 cassette tapes, the very second I said the words amen and they left my lips and I opened my eyes, I found my checkbook there in the middle of my cassette tapes. And I thought to myself, why did I do that? Why did I waste 30, 60 minutes of my life before going to the Lord in prayer? And maybe on some level you can relate to that. You don't even consider prayer until you've tried everything else. Instead of prayer being a first response, it becomes our last resort. When you can't take it anymore, when you've bottomed out, you feel like quitting, you're exhausted, you're frustrated, you're miserable, and then and only then do we turn to the Lord for help. Now today I want to make it crystal clear that God's desire for each and every one of us in this place is that prayer becomes a first response rather than a last resort. Now if I were to walk around person to person in this room and ask the question, how's your prayer life? Because of experience, I know the majority of you would respond with something to the effect of, not so good. Not where I would like it to be. Or it could be a whole lot better. And it begs me to ask the question, why? Why does our communication with the creator of heaven and earth lack so often? Now, maybe we don't go to God in prayer because we think he doesn't care or that he has more important things to do. Like, why am I going to bother God with my little thing when he is busy feeding the hungry and trying to track down ISIS right now? My request seems so small. Or maybe we don't know how to pray. Maybe we're confused because we've gone out with our youth pastor before who took us out to McDonald's, and then we sat down at McDonald's with our well-meaning youth pastor who ordered a double quarter pounder with cheese, a large French fry, a Coca-Cola, threw in a couple of apple pies on the side, and we heard him say, or she say, something to the effect of, "Oh Lord, please bless this food to our body's use." And that doesn't compute, right? We'd have a better time showing up to church in a onesie or footy pajamas and then praying to God that nobody would notice or ask if we lost a bet. Maybe it doesn't add up. Or maybe for a lot of us, we just find that the time is rather unproductive. We've been there, we've done that, we've tried, we've prayed before, and maybe since we were raised as children, the main time we prayed was either before meals or before bed. And so we find our time unproductive. And maybe it goes a little something like this. Hypothetically, of course. There we are. 11:30 at night. Oh. Dear Lord. Dear Lord, I just want to thank you for this one wonderful day. Lord, thank you for my wonderful family and my wonderful house. Thank you for my wonderful bed, Lord. This has been wonderful. Lord, you know, it would be wonderful if my car started in the morning because it's supposed to be cold. God, things are wonderful. Who did I see at church? I said I was going to pray for. Oh man, Lord, it would be wonderful if you just helped me. Oh, God, that was wonderful. Thank you. It's unproductive, right? We set ourselves up to fail. I want to remind us that there is power in prayer. Maybe we're confused, though, too, because we don't pray like the evangelist on television. We flip through the channels, and we hear their prayers. We hear him say something like, "Oh, gracious Heavenly Father, won't thou shine his faith up, there's face upon us peasants of the earthly dominion. We cry out to thee, O magnanimous creator of the Milky Way galaxy and beyond." And we go, "Whoa, wait a minute. I don't sound like that." Friends, that's not a prayer. That's just merely a distraction. Maybe we think that prayer should be left for the professionals, like our pastors or the worship leader or those who are on the prayer team who have the specific gift of intercession, and we should just leave it to them. Guys, prayer is just a simple conversation with God. It's a conversation with God. It's talking to him the way you would a friend, a loved one, even like texting on the phone, shooting them a little message here and there throughout your day. I really think that most of us don't pray because we've forgotten how God has answered in the past, or we really don't comprehend the power and the potential that exists. I have a 4-year-old daughter at home. When she was a year and a half old, we found a lump in her wrist. I don't know a whole lot about the human body, but I'm pretty sure lumps are generally a bad thing. We sent her to a doctor who sent her to a specialist. They took some x-rays, they did an MRI, and they couldn't really figure out what it was, but they're pretty sure it needed to come out. So he took my daughter to a children's hospital to have surgery and get that thing out of her wrist. If you've ever been to a hospital, if you've ever had to put your child under anesthesia before, horrible experience, seeing your child squirm and struggle while a loving father or mother holds them down, keeping the mask, and their body just goes completely limp. We sent her in for surgery, and they took that object out of her wrist and sent it off for testing. And of course, throughout this process, and from the moment we even discovered this lump in my daughter Poppy's wrist, we are praying consistently and constantly for my daughter, asking God that whatever is there, that it would not be cancer, that it would be benign. And when the results came back, the specialist was so confused by the results that he had to look up the name of what it was, because what it was even more rare than cancer. And that's when the specialist, the doctor, actually uttered the words for the first time and said, "I thought it was cancer. But it came back, this other thing, I can't even tell you the name of it, but it's something that, like, literally one in millions will get." So we praise God for that answer prayer. I have a 2.5-year-old son. His name is Tal. Tal, when he was a year old, he wasn't feeling so great, so we took him to a hospital here in Plymouth. They did some blood work, and what we thought might be the flu or something else, after the blood work, they said, "You need to get him down to a hospital in Minneapolis right away." So we took him to a hospital, and they ran some blood work. And that's when I heard the word leukemia spoke over my son. But the blood work at the hospital in Minneapolis was different from the results of the hospital in Plymouth. So they needed to keep him overnight to do a third round of blood work in the morning. So there's my son at about 4 o'clock in the morning just trying to get a little sleep before getting poked and prodded yet again. And as the test results came back in the morning, they said, "The test results that we took are the same, so we feel that the blood work that was done at the other hospital was simply contaminated." Of course, when we took our son to the hospital, we were praying constantly, quite vigorously. And as the doctor said, "We think the results were contaminated," I said, "Well, that's your theory." So I've had cancer spoken over my two kids. And I've seen God's faithfulness. I mention that because I know there are those of you here saying, "Craig, that's great. Awesome story. That's not my story. God doesn't seem to be answering me the way he answered you. I've tried and I've been praying and praying and praying. It hurts. Why is he not listening? I get it. What I say to you is don't give up and keep trying and keep praying. But also realize that God may not answer those prayers. He may not. And the question, of course, comes up, why? What am I doing wrong? What's wrong with me? I don't want to spend a whole lot of time on this, but there is a possibility that we are doing something wrong. And I have to at least acknowledge that, not to heap guilt, but to create perhaps a realization. We look in Scripture that there are some things that will hinder our prayers at times or seasons in our life. It may be that there's some unconfessed sin that we need to lay out before God and get that taken care of before we present other requests to Him. I never wanted to confess my sin in prayer because then God would find out my sin. Trust me, friends, he already knows. Maybe we're praying with selfish motives. It's something that we want. It's something that we think we need. And our motives are completely off base and where they need to be. Perhaps in our hearts there's unforgiveness and we're coming to the throne and we're praying to the Lord, but there's junk and we need to forgive someone else if we desire to be forgiven. And if we want to be effective in our prayer life, we need to forgive those who need to be forgiven. And maybe some of you say, Pastor Craig, how do I forgive someone who doesn't want to be forgiven, who is not asking for forgiveness, who doesn't even know what they have done or what they are doing? I don't know how you do that, but I know that Jesus came as a human being. And because Jesus looked down from the cross and said to those who put him there, Father, forgive them, they don't know what they are doing. That we too, because of Jesus' example through humanity, have the ability to do the same. Maybe there's doubt. Maybe it's just lip service. You're saying the words, but you don't believe it in your heart. Or husbands, I'm just saying, maybe you're being a jerk towards your wife. And if you want to be effective in your prayer walk, you need to change that relationship. Bottom line is, I don't know. Okay, that's my big theological statement for the day. Why does it work for some and not for others? I don't know. But I will say this, God doesn't always answer my prayers either. I've got bad knees. I don't think my knees are the problem. There's something else, but the knees are where I feel the pain, and it's pretty consistent, and it's pretty constant, and it's 24/7. Sometimes I lay in my bed at night, and my knees just ache and ache and ache. I could walk out of the parking lot and just slip a tiny little bit on the ice, and it's going to shoot excruciating pain through my body. It's not fun. I've asked God to take it away hundreds, if not thousands of times. I've had hands laid on my body, and people pray for healing when the same people are healing people all around me except for me, and I'm thinking to myself, what did I do wrong? I've been in situations where people are getting healed all around me, and I'm scratching my head. I'm going, okay, God, what's up? Is this not loud enough? Is it not repetitive enough? What's the deal? Last night, when my daughter came into my room and said, Dad, I need to throw up, and I got down by her bed, and I said, Lord, please, 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 let this be the last one. Number 6. It wasn't the last one. And God did not answer that prayer. I try to think of prayer a little bit like a traffic light. Because like a traffic light, there are some options when we pull up to it. A traffic light has 3 possibilities. Number 1, we pull up and we get what we hope and what we desire and what we pray for, and that's the green light. You may proceed. Sometimes we are going to get the yellow light, which, contrary to popular belief, does not mean speed up. It means slow down, not yet. And then we may get the red light, which of course means stop. In our prayer life, we have the same 3 options. There are times where God will give us the green light, he will grant our request, and he says, yes, I will answer. I will give you what you are asking for, and we love that. What's a little bit harder to deal with is the yellow light when God is saying, not yet. Not in your time, but in my timing. Be patient, stick with it, keep on praying, and I'll get to it when the timing is right. And what's even more difficult is when we get that red light and God is just saying no. The answer is no. And whether you're 5 or 95, nobody likes to hear the word no. When we hear the no, when we get that red light, I want each of us to remember a couple of things. When we get the red light, first of all, we need to remind ourselves that God knows what's best. God knows what's best for us. My son Tal, at age 2.5, thinks he knows what's best for his life. What does my son love? He loves candy. He loves basketball, he loves the drums, and he loves candy. And so my son will ask, if not demand, candy, 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 candy. And so if I'm feeling like a real generous dad, I might hand my son a little Hershey's Kiss. And after I hand him that Hershey's Kiss, my son will turn to me and say, "Thank you, Father. I am completely satisfied with that one Hershey's Kiss. I will now move on with the things I was doing before." Of course not. What does he want after I give him a Hershey's Kiss? Another Hershey's Kiss. Candy, candy, candy. And he will look at me and say, "One more, one more." But I know what's best for my son. My brain is more developed, hard for some of you to believe, but it is more developed than my 2.5-year-old son. I know what is best for him. So when we get that green light from the Lord, when we are asking and praying and it seems like our prayers are hitting this spiritual ceiling and falling back down to earth, we need to remember that God knows what's best, and we also need to remember that God sees the big picture. In the same way that I see the big picture, I know what's going to happen if I give my son a bag of Hershey Kisses in an hour and in 3 hours and the next morning. God sees the big picture of our life. He is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. Always has been, and he is, and always will be. He sees the timeline and he knows the big picture. In the year 1990, when I was a junior in high school, I was disgusted by what I heard when I walked into the high school locker room before a football game. It was country music coming out of a boombox that somebody had snuck in. And it was an artist by the name of Garth Brooks. Garth Brooks had a song on an album called No Fences. And the song I didn't mind. Didn't really like country music, still don't. If you do, please forgive me, don't come kick me with your boots. But he had a song called Unanswered Prayers. And here's what he said. "Sometimes I thank God for unanswered prayers." Just like that. And he said, "Remember when you're talking to the man upstairs that just because he doesn't answer doesn't mean he doesn't care. Some of God's greatest gifts are unanswered prayers." Now, he was saying that and singing that because he looked back on his life and he was able to say, "Oh my Lord, thank you so much for not answering that prayer I was praying," because he's looking back and able to see that God really knew what he was doing the whole time. Now, some of you would argue and say, "Well, Craig, God answers all the prayers. Every prayer we pray, he answers. But it's not always the way we would like him to answer." I get that. Now, what would happen exactly if God answered all of our prayers the way we wanted him to? Now, we can learn just a little bit from the movie Bruce Almighty, where God gave a man named Bruce the opportunity to have God's power and ability for a certain section of Buffalo, New York. And Bruce had the task of answering the prayers of everyone in the city of New York. And he got so tired with all the requests as he sat down at his prayer computer, he just simply typed in the word "yes to all" and hit send. And the next morning, there was chaos in Buffalo. Granted, the Buffalo Sabres happened to win the Stanley Cup, but everyone who won the lottery happened to win the lottery, which amounted to about $17 per person after taxes. And it was chaos. I truly believe the main lesson that we need to learn when we are receiving that red light from God is to learn to submit our ways to the Father the way Jesus did. Again, he's our example. You see, Jesus did not want to go to the cross. There's a whole lot of love, but if you remember in the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus prayed, and he had a conversation with his Father. And in the book of Matthew, chapter 26, verses 36 through 39, we read this. Then Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to them, "Sit here while I go over there and pray." He took Peter and the two sons of Zebedee along with him, and he began to be sorrowful and troubled. Then he said to them, "My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me." Going a little farther, he fell with his face to the ground and prayed, "My Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me. May this cup pass from me." That was Jesus' prayer to his Father. Is it possible? Let this cup pass from me. This was what he pleaded with his Father to take the suffering away. Now, I don't even doubt for a second that there are those of us in this room who desperately either want God to do or want God to take away a situation that you are faced with right now. You are saying to God, "Not this, anything but this. Lord, not in my lifetime. Is there any other way? What's the plan B?" But God, in his absolute goodness and sovereignty, doesn't take the hardship away. In that moment of struggle, it becomes monumentally important as a follower of Christ to learn how to submit to God, to understand that he sees the big picture, to understand that he knows what's best. And we asked ourselves the question, how did Jesus respond? First, he went to prayer, and it was authentic. It was an authentic prayer. God knows what's in our hearts anyways. We need to acknowledge our need and our thinking and our attitude by pouring out authentic prayer. "Lord, I can't do this. Lord, I need your help." But Jesus is still not through either. There's an authentic prayer, and there's also a submissive prayer in this. As the Lord wrestled with the Father, he was essentially asking, "Is there any other way?" He prayed and he prayed and he prayed while those around him slept. He was under such turmoil and stress, he dropped great sweat of blood. And his final words were this: "Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will." And when he was done praying, the struggle was over, victory was won. Now, maybe you're in that place of struggle right now. You have to go through the process of submission over and over again. And as humans, we tend to focus on how prayer changes circumstances. But in the garden, I notice here more clearly how prayer changes me, how prayer changes us. And we could list all the great circumstantial things that happen because of prayer, but let me tell you that these aren't the greatest answers that we've seen. When God changes you through prayer, that's the best answer. But again, I know that there's skeptics. There are those of us sitting in here saying, "Craig, just trust me, man. Trust me, I've tried, I've done it, and God doesn't answer me." This is a picture of a wall in the youth room of the former church where I was the youth pastor, First Baptist Church in Long Prairie, Minnesota. And every Thursday morning, I would get together with a group of students and we would pray before school. We would eat pastries with way too much sugar, have cereal with the same amount of sugar, and then we would pray. And I would write all the prayer requests down on a flip chart. And each week we would come back to those prayer requests, and the student who asked for a certain prayer, we would say, "Has God answered that yet, or do we need to keep praying?" And if there was an answer, we would take a Sharpie permanent marker and we would write the answer to those prayers on the wall. Sometimes they were gigantic. Most of the time they were things like, "I passed my test." Here's something that I wrote on April 21st of 2011. I didn't mess up any of my dance moves at Just for Kicks. You say, "Pastor Craig, that's a little creepy." There was a 16-year-old girl in my youth group whose father had moved away to the West Coast. The rest of the family was going to be joining him, but she came to me and said, "Pastor Craig, would you be my dad for the father-daughter dance at the recital?" And I looked at her and I said, "There is nothing that I would least rather do in my life, but I will do that for you." And I didn't mess up any of my moves. And that's an answer to prayer. We had a Wipeout viewing party in Long Prairie where we invited the community to come and watch the TV show Wipeout because my wife was a contestant on the show. You can Google search Cheeseball Molly Wipeout and you can see it for yourself. We didn't know how she was going to be represented on television because you know what editors can do. She was represented pretty well, and that was an answer to prayer. Somebody wrote, "My pimple is gone." Anybody ever pray for a pimple to be gone? Remember when you woke up Monday morning in school, grade school, and all of a sudden you saw that on your face and you're like, "Oh, Heavenly Father, come quickly." Byron said, "I figured out what I'm going to do after high school." Anyone figure out what they were going to do after high school and took that to the Lord in prayer? I'm saying this, I'm showing you these things so that you can remember what is on and has been on your prayer wall. We finally sold our Volkswagen Beetle. Praise God, we got it out of my driveway. On the windowsill in the upper right, Shenny wrote, "Poppy's okay." Dad's tests went well and the cancer is gone. Grace signed that on March 5th of 2009. Remember this? On 12/12/12, the world did not come to an end, which means we still have more time to tell people about Jesus. I ask you this question as I close. What's on your prayer wall? What do you need to be reminded of, little or big, where God was faithful in your life? The same power that the prophet Elijah had is the same power that we have today. Whether things are going well or just plain horrible, we need to pray. Because I believe in a power that helps college kids find their checkbook. A power that can bless a double quarter pounder with cheese to a body's use if it's within the Lord's will. I believe in the power that can move mountains, heal the sick, tear down racism, restore marriages, renovate victims of abuse, and derails depression. A power that helps runaways find a home, annihilates anger, breaks down strongholds of addiction. A power that cripples cults and brings non-believers to their knees. I'm talking about the power of prayer. Tonight, before you go, this morning, before you go, I want to challenge you to do one of two things. Number one, come up front and receive prayer from someone on our prayer team. Or number two, before you leave this room, share with someone else one thing that's on your prayer wall. One way that God came through in your life, small or big. That's your assignment. It's no secret that as we have started this series, we've talked about prayer because bottom line is this: you will not get very far on the walk if you and God never talk. Let's pray. Father, I thank you again for the awesome privilege we have to come and present our requests to you. God, may we stick with it. Lord, we thank you and praise you for the ways that you have come through in our life. We thank you for the ways that you change us through prayer. And we praise you for the times that we get those green lights and you say, yes. And God, for those who are struggling, would you meet them where they are at? Remind us again and again that you know what's best, that you see the big picture. God, may we trust you with our lives. And we pray this in your Son, Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. You know your assignment. Go with God.